Is this working?
Hello? Can you hear me?
And you can hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
All right. Okay, so David has an amazing art show a few blocks from here, but we're going to see a movie tonight. And I feel like there's certain themes that recur in everything he does. So I'm going to address those things, and they apply to his paintings and his films. Central to all of your work has been the struggle between light and dark, the struggle between good and evil. And in your early films, the first four, for instance, Blue Velvet, Wild at Heart, Straight Story, Elephant Man, good prevails in the end. In the last three films, that hasn't really been the case, Mulholland Drive, Inland Empire, and Lost Highway. Has there been a fundamental change in your view of human nature or life?
Inland Empire ends on a high note.
Oh, come on. Really?
Yeah.
Okay, then the answer to the question is no.
What was the question again?
Do you have a more negative view of human nature?
No, I have a very positive view. I always told you, I get ideas, and the ideas mostly come from our world. But the ideas come, and once in a while, they say, I get an idea that's a cinema idea, and I fall in love. And then I just try to stay true to that idea and translate that to cinema. And some ideas have a more positive resolution, and some not.
Not so positive, mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. I'll try to talk about Lost Highway without giving anything away, but one thing I can say to that, Lost Highway presents sexual desire as an agent of destruction. Do you think that part of the power of sexual desire is that there's an element of risk?
Oh, for sure.
Anything more?
You know, sex is, we could talk for a long time.
Okay, let's go.
No. It, like many things, has a wide range. It can be very, very sublime and high, and spiritual even, or it could be the reverse. But it has to do with combinations. So everybody knows that it's the combo of two people, and each combo, even though you might be the same, the second person is different. And so it's always a different thing. It's very fascinating.
Okay, that's it for sex. It's fascinating. Okay, one more bit about that, though. Why are we drawn to things that are potentially, obviously bad for us?
We don't necessarily want to go to something that's bad for us. When you're in love or you're filled with a strong desire, it's difficult to overcome that. And a lot of times the mind is saying one thing and desire and emotion is saying another. And it's an age-old story.
Often a tragedy.
Often a tragedy.
There's a character in Lost Highway that fundamentally represents pure evil. I guess you could call him the devil. And he makes a comment in the film that, I don't go anywhere unless I'm invited in, which suggests that people have some power over the degree of corruption in their life. Do you think that's true?
Absolutely. Yes, you have free will, and you can make decisions. And like I said, it's a kind of a battle between desire and the reasoning mind.
Which one usually wins?
Desire.
Yeah. Okay, well, just continuing with this theme. In 1986, we were talking on the set of Blue Velvet, and you said that they say love is blind, and it's true that people appear to be perfect when you're in love with them. Then little by little, you start seeing these blemishes and flaws. They seem to grow larger and larger, and the initial burst of feeling cools. Why does love die? Why do we stop being enchanted with one another?
That's a real good question. I think it's familiarity, and it's like a car. You fall in love with a car, you save up your money or take a loan, and you're just thrilled with that car. And then you drive it, and you wash it, and keep it perfect, and you're so happy going along. And then about a year later, it's kind of dirty, there's some scratches. And you're driving along, and you see another car.
Oh my God.
Yeah, this isn't in my questions, but you once talked about, we were talking about the difference between men and women, and you said men want to hunt. Women don't have that, but it's a man can say, I don't want to hunt, I'm not going to hunt, but you want to hunt.
Yeah.
That, you probably all know that. You once commented that people come into life with a karmic debt, and if you believe in reincarnation, it all makes sense. It may seem like some people get away with murder. When you factor in reincarnation, it becomes clear that there's perfect justice in the world. So do you feel like everyone pays for what they do?
Absolutely perfect justice in the big picture. Big, big picture, perfect justice. And it explains many, many, many things. How come somebody gets such a great, you know, free ride and things just go very well, and other people are suffering and going through all kinds of things? It's part of the story. They say, charged with how we treat our fellow man. And so whatever we do to someone else, we are in effect doing that exact same thing to ourselves.
Okay. Well, that leads to my one other sort of complicated spiritual question. In Hinduism, there's the belief that humanity is going through four epochs of time, thousands and thousands of years, and we're now in the fourth of the epochs, the Kali Yuga, when man is at his most depraved and unconscious and despicable. If this is all predestined, why should we even try to behave?
Oh, you need to behave.
Why?
To keep yourself from suffering, for one thing. And they say this Kali Yuga lasts 432,000 years. Mm-hmm. But we are in a very beautiful time in this Kali Yuga. And everybody's heard of the Age of Aquarius, a small golden age in the middle of the Iron Age, the lowest age. And so the world may seem to be coming apart right now, but I think it's getting better and better. And even though the president is supposed to be giving some talk tonight about going in and doing something in Syria and Iraq, most of the world is in better shape than it was, you know, in the last thousands of years. And it's we're headed for, I think, a very good time.
Wow, I'm glad to hear that. What aspect of the future, as you envision it, is most alarming to you?
I'm not really, there have been many alarming things that have happened in the past. I think technology and reasoning mind are being tested. Right now, we have the technology to end, you know, a lot of lives, and but I think more and more people are desiring peace and not wanting to kill one another.
That's, I support that. Talking about the future. Your paintings have a really handmade feeling. All of your art, really, the presence of the painter is really there. And yet you've totally embraced digital technology. Do you think the days are gonna come when the handmade, the touch of the artist will be gone?
No, I think because of piracy, digital things become cheaper and cheaper. And they're easy to take and steal and share and whatever. But lithograph, for instance, is something that you can have, and when you have it, you see the beauty of the paper and the feel and smell of the ink, and it's so different from a digital print. So I think painting will always be alive and well, but the digital world opens up a whole other thing. Photoshop is one of the most magical tools going ever invented. It's incredible. And all these things, so you can almost, if you can think it, you can find a way to do it these days.
So get the ideas. The lead character in Lost Highway makes a comment, "I like to remember things my own way, not necessarily the way they happened," which suggests there is no absolute reality. We create our own reality.
Yeah, there is. There is memory. Every single thing they say is recorded. People got a real idea of that with Snowden, is that his name?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But everything is being recorded. And what was the second part of that question?
Well, yes, it is. Just because it's recorded doesn't make it true. We decide what's true.
The way it's recorded is absolutely the way it happened. But our memory of it, as everybody here knows, we have this way of wanting it to be something that we can live with, and we alter the past in our memory.
So how much power do we have to re-fictionalize our lives?
Everybody's different, but a lot of power.
So there's people who think they're creeps and they're really nice, and the opposite is true, I guess.
Maybe so. The psychiatrist's office are full.
Okay. You once made a comment about a psychiatrist. You said going to psychiatry is like spending hours telling somebody how thirsty you are when what you really need is a drink of water. Yes. There are two male lead characters in Lost Highway, and they seem to morph in and out of each other. It's like identity is very fluid. Do you think we all contain multiples, that there are always many versions of us in each of us?
Not really. I think, you know, the mind can trick itself, and that's a little bit possibly what's going on.
And I guess we have to do that to be able to live with ourselves.
We have to do that to be able to live with ourselves.
Yeah. You once commented, "I like my films to feel grounded in America, but that's not the case with my paintings. They could be anywhere."
I don't remember saying that.
You said it this morning! You said it this morning! Yes, you did!
So, my memory is different than yours.
No, but you did say that you're
painting. I never mentioned America this morning.
Okay, we'll move on. Where are your paintings?
I like if it's an American idea. Now, The Elephant Man, for instance, took place in Victorian England.
That's a very good point.
And so it's the idea takes you to those things, and you stay true to the idea.
Mm-hmm.
The places where we live can give us ideas. So I live in Los Angeles, so sometimes that feeds ideas.
Mm-hmm. Where do the paintings live?
The paintings are, they can come from the world, from Los Angeles. Ideas come in, but I always say there's ideas for everything. So if you get an idea for a chair, in your mind, on the screen, you'll see a chair. And you'll say, and it's a different kind of chair. And you fall in love with that. And then you notice what it's made of. It's made of steel and wood. And so you then get those materials, and as you go into the shop, you keep checking the picture in your mind, and you build that, you translate that into the chair in the shop. The same way with cinema ideas. You have that in your mind, the feeling of it, the sound of it, to one degree or another. And you have it has a sound and a feel and a look and a mood, and you try to stay true to that as you translate it to the cinema. They talk to you, the ideas.
You once said that Eraserhead was, of all your films, the one that is absolutely the truest to the way it was in your head.
Many, many things in Eraserhead, I would close my eyes and it would be, I'd open it in this cinema and it would be very close.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
And you said that that was your most spiritual film.
The most spiritual film. No one has ever gotten it from it.
Well, can you elaborate on
it? No, I can't elaborate.
But I won't.
The way it happened was I had these ideas, and I had a feeling of something more than what it was, but I didn't know what it really was about for me. So I get out the Bible, and I start reading, and I'm reading along, and it just happened, I see this sentence, and I said, that's exactly it.
What's the sentence?
And I never say.
The whole Bible will try to find it.
Homework for tonight.
You've commented that you like the feeling of people coming out of darkness, and that's something in a lot of your work. What appeals to you about that?
It's the story of humanity. And they say we you know, fall and then we rise, or we get lost and we find our way home. And so you can be very lost and living in darkness, but you can find your way home, and you can find that light, become a light unto yourself. And it's a story. And they say it's the story of silence, the story of the absolute. And we're all part of the world family. We all are, they say, sparks off the divine flame. We all are together in this story. Everybody has something, a part to play, like Shakespeare says. It's really beautiful. We're on a big trip.
It's a good trip. Your lithographs often depict people who are bound and constrained and struggling to transcend. What are we struggling to transcend?
Well, transcend is a word. Everybody heard about the field of relativity and that there's different dimensions. They say there's 10 dimensions of space, 1 dimension of time. And underlying all matter and mind is a field of pure consciousness, modern science's unified field, the unity of all the particles and forces. And this field underlying all matter and mind has been there forever. It's eternal, always been there. In the Vedic language, it's called Nitya and Aparishaya, meaning eternal and uncreated. No one created that field. It's always been, and it will always be. And when a person gets a technique like transcendental meditation, which I practice, you can transcend the whole field of relativity and experience that unbounded consciousness within, which has these qualities of intelligence, creativity, happiness, known as bliss, energy, love, and peace within every human being. You can get there. And when you experience it, you infuse some and you grow in that, and things get better and better and better. It's a human being thing.
Sounds good.
Very good.
Could someone abuse that power?
No. That unified field, that ocean of consciousness within, is all positive. And it's when we lose that, when we no longer have contact with that, that's when you can get into trouble. it's like we're out in the darkness, and that's a field of pure light, just unbounded, you know, light of life and, you know, consciousness, the I amness of life. And that every human being has a potential, a full potential called supreme enlightenment, and we can unfold that. And that's the end of the, actually they say enlightenment is the beginning of the story, but that's where we're all headed, whether we realize it or not, whether we're taught in school or not, to get our birthright, which is enlightenment, eternal, immortal, immutable, unbounded, infinite, bliss, consciousness, on the field of all possibilities, no more suffering, no more negativity. Very, very beautiful. It's not like Lost Highway.
Have you known many people in life that you would describe as enlightened?
I've heard stories, and the beautiful part of it is, it's a trick. You can't prove any of this, really. It's a subjective science, and so it's an internal thing. But now with brain research, they can see on the EEG machine patterns of enlightenment, and people can say their experiences, and they put that together with what they see the brain doing, and it's very, very beautiful. It's a true thing. There are higher states of consciousness beyond waking, sleeping, and dreaming, and we all have that potential to have those higher states of consciousness. It's really, 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 it makes us feel very good to know that that's there.
Are you there when you're making your work?
No, I'm not enlightened. I like to think I'm on the path toward that. And like they say, when you walk toward the light, with each step toward the light, things get brighter. The more you transcend, the better things get. So it's money in the bank to visit that field within, you know, on a daily basis.
You once described your paintings as, you said they're all violent comedies. How can violence be a way of expressing comedy?
That's the absurdity of violence, probably. People, there's an absurdity to it.
Okay. That's it. You also, in 2008, you made a lithograph, and the title was Who Pulls the Strings? Who does?
Ultimately, we pull our own strings. But I think that in the world, there's, you know, there's things that come to light with the internet and more people out sharing their ideas and what they discovered. There seems to be something going on in the world that is a kind of a controlling thing, like we're a bunch of little sheep that they shear our wool off, and we don't have much to say about it.
Are you talking about the deluge of information that we're all subjected to?
No.
What are you referring to? The people pulling the strings?
No, maybe I'm just paranoid. Does anybody feel that way?
Yeah, you know, David was saying earlier, you don't watch television except when you're in hotels, and neither did I, and it's so upsetting what's going on.
Yeah. It's a, you can save yourself a lot of trouble by not watching TV.
Exactly. Okay, this is one of your quotes that I've always loved. You said, you know what dogs are like in a room? They really look like they're having fun. They're bouncing this ball around and chewing on stuff, and they're panting and happy. Human beings are supposed to be like that, and we're not. we should basically be pretty happy, and we're not. Why are most people dissatisfied with their lives?
I started meditating when I heard the phrase, or I started getting interested in meditation when I heard the phrase, true happiness is not out there, true happiness lies within. And that phrase had a ring of truth to it, to me. And then I thought, well, maybe meditation is a way to go within and find that happiness. Then I found out there's 10,000 different kinds of meditation. And so I started looking into this or this or this. So it's, we try to find happiness out there, and we do find it. But like the car, we live in a world of change, so things change, and then we start looking for happiness someplace else. This happiness that's within each one of us, the big treasury of bliss, that doesn't go away. When you experience it, infuse that, start growing in that, it just keeps there. And you start getting real happy from the inside, and the world looks better, and relationships improve, and you're happier in the doing. It's very, very, very good. And you can start, if we had tails, they would just start wagging.
You've meditated twice a day for decades. Is there a great variety in your meditations?
They say the meditation of a beginner in transcendental meditation looks somewhat like a long, long time meditator. But you gain this coherence, you gain this, thing that in the beginner, it dissipates pretty quick after meditation, and the long time meditator, it stays. It's like the analogy is a white cloth, you're going to dye gold. In the beginning, you dip in the gold dye, you hang it out on the line, and the sun bleaches out almost every little bit of gold. And you dip it again, hang it out on the line, and little by little by little, it gets more and more gold, and one day it is solid. And you can hang it on the line, the sun doesn't take out any bit, it's solid gold.
I have a lot more questions, but I think we're supposed to have some audience. Can I ask one last question?
Sure, sure.
Okay, I once asked you what the most important historical event of the 20th century was, and you said the birth of rock and roll. Do you still believe that?
Of the 20th century?
20th century.
That was a smart-ass answer, I think.
Okay, well, what do you got today? It's kind of a cool answer.
It was a big event, the birth of rock and roll. And it brought a brand new thing and a lot of happiness to people.
So you gonna go with that?
Well, honestly, I think this, I think bringing out this Vedic knowledge, which is, Veda means pertaining to total knowledge. I think, Maharishi has brought out techniques that really unfold a human being's full potential, bring happiness, enlightenment, and it's now been shown, in all this research on this technique and techniques, it brings so much happiness to the people and stops the suffering and makes you like a happy little dog. I think that's even greater than Elvis Presley.
So, questions. Is there somebody out there who's with a microphone?
You can ask it, and I can try to repeat the question.
Okay.
Yeah, you can ask it.
Okay, so this is my boyfriend, Bobby, and he writes screenplays, and he's got a shot list and everything all set for this weekend. He's making his first film. I just wondered if you had any advice for him.
He's sitting next to her girlfriend, or boyfriend, Bobby, and he's got a script, and he's ready to shoot, and he's got his shot list and the whole thing. and he wants maybe some advice. So I say the same thing over and over. Stay true to the idea. Stay true to every element. And that means that the sounds, the music, the mood of the light, the fast and slow of stay true to the idea. And don't walk away from anything until it feels correct to you. To you. Never turn down a good idea, but don't ever take a bad idea. And try to enjoy yourself while you do it.
Thank you. Excellent advice.
I'm not getting together a new film, no. What films are part of the past do I like to revisit the most? I haven't seen, I have two sons. One, I sat down when he was 14 and saw with him each film. And that's the last time I've seen them. But, and he's now like 75 years old. But I think it's good to go back and see things sometimes. I was saying that this morning, like painting, for instance, seeing old work, sometimes it fuels the new stuff. And so it's good to do that from time to time.
Hi, so you've been talking about lightness and darkness through your films and in your life and throughout the world. And one of the things that made me think about recently was, you know, the death of Robin Williams, how people were talking so much about the brightness, the happiness that he brought in his performance, but it also masked an underlying darkness, the depression and the suffering that he experienced. And I don't know if you could reflect something up, say something about that. It's connecting to some of the things that you've been saying.
I couldn't hear the last part.
It's connecting to some of the things that you've been saying, and so I was wondering if you had any thoughts relating to lightness and darkness.
Well, it's this thing of a lot of comedians, they said, like Jonathan Winters, who Robin Williams loved, they're kind of in and out of the funny farm.
And he was manic depressive.
Yeah, and so they live kind of on an edge. And they said, like, I think Dick Cavett, he suffered from depression, and he said that it's so dark in there, so dark, and his friends would come by, and he knew they were trying to cheer him up, but it didn't do one bit of good. This thing of depression is so overwhelming. The world looks completely different to a depressed person. And unfortunately, it can get to where suicide saves you. You can't stand to be alive. And I can just say, you've got a treasury of happiness within. Give it a try to learn the technique to transcend and experience that happiness. And you can get out of that. You can restore, you know, a balance and health, mental health and physical health. And it's a real blessing. And then there's, you know, sometimes pharmaceutical drugs can really help as well. But a lot of times they have these side effects that you hear on TV. I hear them on TV. And they go on and on and on. And a lot of times the side effects are worse than the thing you took, the thing, the pill to cure. Hello. Thanks. I have a music studio, a sound studio. It was built to experiment with sound. And then I got more, the sound effects became more musical. I worked with my friend Big Dean Hurley, and we made two albums, and it was really a beautiful experience. I think we'll do it again. Thanks a lot for saying that.
Am I the
You're picking, yeah.
Thanks for coming back to Philadelphia. I'd love to hear, you know, you talk about how Philadelphia inspired you and what it's like to be back here.
The question is, what inspired me about Philadelphia and what it's like to be back? I sort of, I don't know, in the 60s, Philadelphia was very, very different. Now Philadelphia has been, at least down here in the Center City, has been cleaned up a lot. For instance, the academy where I went to school was almost black when I was there. It was completely soot covered and you couldn't see red bricks. It was just a black building, but it had a beauty to me, a very beautiful patina. And even the streets seemed to be filthy, and there was no graffiti. Everything was pure. The buildings in Philadelphia were built in a very strong and good way. There was a great hardware store, Buck's Hardware, that I used to go to. Every place had a kind of a mood, but swimming in the atmosphere was huge fear and a chance for big violence. There was a feeling of corruption. There was a feeling of despair. There was a feeling of insanity. And it all sort of swam together. Now the city seems much brighter and cleaner and more ordinary to me.
Could you stand up and maybe?
Oh, you want to stand? Sure. Yeah, I was just curious, you know, I really enjoyed a lot of your films and Twin Peaks, but something that kind of came out of the blue was your story arc on Louie. So I was just wondering how that came about and how you enjoyed that experience.
The question is about how did I enjoy the experience working with Louis C.K. and how did it come about? I think there were about 14 people ahead of me for that role. And I all turned Louis down. Louis wrote me these letters. I said no a couple of times, and then he'd write me another letter. And he wrote beautiful letters. And then I read the scripts, and the scripts were really great, really great. And Louis said they all came pouring out in one continuous waterfall of words and ideas. And I was really impressed. I didn't want to do it because it's a very frightening thing to act, but he and I don't like to travel too much, and he got me to go from LA to New York and go into a hotel and go get, you know, and act. So he's a pretty incredible guy. But he was great to work with.
I would like to say thank you for the Twin Peaks Blu-ray and for finally releasing the missing pieces. I'm a big Dog Gang fan, and on the missing pieces there's one song called One Dog Bark, and I was wondering if that's an old song or something you recently recorded with Angelo.
He's talking about the deleted scenes of Twin Peaks and the new Blu-ray. And there's a song, One Dog Bark, that Angelo and I worked on those things. There is music for an album called Thought Gang, but it's never been out. It needs some more work. But we did that in the early 90s. It was way, way ahead of its time. I don't know when we'll get that out, but that One Dog Bark would be on that album. A portion of that is in the deleted scenes.
So I was told to cut off questions in 2 minutes, so, okay.
Is there such a thing as a mistake, and how do you correct those things? Yeah, there are mistakes, but that's why I said to you about your stay true to the idea. Don't walk away from any element till it feels correct. And I say the number one tool of the artist, or pretty much the number one tool of a human being, is intuition. It's a knowingness. And that thing of intuition can be found within also. That's a field of all knowingness within each one of us. And when that thing gets flowing, it tells you that it's not correct, and it tells you a way to make it correct. So it's a very, very beautiful thing, this thing of knowingness. It's kind of unbelievable that there would be a thing like that, but it's true. There's a thing called happy accidents. And sometimes you might make a mistake, but out of it could come something that conjures an idea that is such a blessing. And you just don't know how you got so lucky to get that thing, but it came out of a strange accident. And so I say always you should be on guard as you make something, because something could come along, an idea that you never thought you would work for this thing you're working on, but then you realize it's the missing ingredient, it's the missing thing. How could it be any other way? And you're just so thankful to get that.
I'm sorry I didn't pick in the back. I didn't know I was going to be the picker, and I can't see anybody yet. But one more question.
Hi. In both Mulholland Drive and Inland Empire, people in the film who are making the film, are kind of sinister characters. There's something inherently cruel about the way these films are happening. Why did you choose to go that way in making...
What I don't understand that they're sinister, the people making the film, within the film in Mulholland Drive.
I could explain.
You can.
Okay, remember there's a scene where Naomi Watts has to go audition for that part, and she's like killer. Mm-hmm. But there's kind of these lascivious, creepy guys around her. It's like it's predatory. They're preying on her.
Oh, I didn't feel that.
Oh. Okay, never mind. I don't understand.
No, I think, auditioning is, terrible, terrible thing. And I never make people read, a scene. I just talk to them. And so that's that scene. There are lots of game playing and politics and some kind of happiness in seeing people fail or suffer. It's a complicated business. But Kristine said, and Naomi did such a beautiful job.
Yeah, she's awesome in that scene.
Yeah.
Andrew, is Andrew around? The guy in charge? Okay, one more question.
Thank you so much for sharing.
It's great being here with y'all tonight. No, he had a question.
I have to say thank you so much for coming out and for sharing your art with us in general and your time here. We really, really appreciate it. And my question time, so we've got to figure one out to answer the real question. Do you like pizza?
Do I like pizza? That's the question. I like that real thin, more brittle, more Italian. Yeah. You're gonna get hungry during this. But may you give me your card?
Why are you a pizza maker?
I work for friends of mine that are pizza makers in the city, and if you have any time and you want to have some of the best pizza in Philadelphia.
Okay, fantastic. You guys enjoy the film, okay?